And then last week we talked about woman made in God's image. And we got to like the last couple minutes of class. We didn't get to look at a lot of the verses. So we're going to go ahead and look back through those verses tonight. And then we're going to move on to women's roles in society. So one thing I wanted to start with was January 24th and January 31st. Those are both Wednesdays. We're going to be looking at examples of Old and New Testament women. And I would like for, if anybody is interested in preparing something, it would be just like 5 minutes or so. It wouldn't have to be anything long. You could pick someone for yourself, or you could ask me and I could give you someone to look at and give us like an overview of. I brought a book tonight called All the Women of the Bible. It's like a resource if you wouldn't like sit and read it. But say like today, I was thinking about Anna. And I was like, I don't really remember where she is. I don't remember everything about her. So this, when I look up Anna, it tells me where she is in the Bible. It also tells me some kind of outside information, some things we know from other places, not just scripture, but other historical documents and stuff. So I brought this so y'all could look at it if you were interested, but you didn't know who to study. And I'm always available for questions if you've never really put something together like that, or maybe you have and you haven't done it in a while. So anyways, I just wanted to put that so that you guys can kind of start thinking about it and working on it if that's something you're interested in. Now, last week when we closed, I asked y'all to kind of think about this question. Maybe you had time, maybe you didn't, but we're going to take a couple minutes just to talk about this. So what ways do you think that our failure to be suitable helpers manifests today?
The divorce rate.
That's a good indication. I think in some ways when we get to the point with our husbands where we don't let them do anything and we're like helicopter wives, that's kind of a funny phrase. I've never thought about that. But I think that's kind of a way that we, rather than recognizing that they're holding this burden and we're supposed to be supporting them in that, we kind of say, well, they're not good enough, or they're not, you know, whatever, they're not mindful enough, and we kind of take charge instead of trying to teach them and make them a better man, better able to do what it is they're supposed to do.
Our society, I mean, you sitcoms and things like that, they like to show the man in just a foolish light. Mm-hmm. And the woman is the one who has to straighten it all out. I mean, that's in our world that we're living in right now, that's what they really like to push. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we ought to encourage our husbands. I mean, they can all use encouragement regardless, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
If they're capable and don't have any struggles with this issue, it's still good to hear that sometimes and be encouraged, yeah.
Yeah, it can be hard to not talk about our husbands in that way. And it's not always that we even see them that way, but it is kind of like that's what we expect to hear from other women. And so that's what we, like, give back to them. I was thinking about that recently. I was thinking, like, why it's so hard to talk positively about your spouse, even if you, like, actually do think positively of them. And I think that's a lot to do with it is we're used to hearing from other people, you know, oh, well, my wife nags and she's always telling me what to do and blah, blah, blah. And they may really appreciate their wife, but at the same time, it's like that's not what people are used to telling other people. And so the easy thing is, well, I'll just complain about my husband and I'll say he never listens, or I'll say he never does this or he never does that, when in the back of my head, I'll probably be thinking, well, but he does do this and he does do this. And so,
it's not to brag.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's not our nature to brag.
Yeah. Even when it's about someone else, right? Unless it's our kids. I think a lot of people brag about their kids. Anything else? Okay. All right. So, these were the scriptures that we put up on the board last week. So, you may have them copied down already. you may not, but we're going to go through all of the highlighted ones. So if you particularly want to write down the not highlighted two, then we'll read through the other ones right now. And we'll just go around. If Gina, if you could start and read that one. Can you read it?
My golden appears now is a beautiful woman without discretion.
So as a suitable helper, we have to be discreet. And I think that's really important as a minister's wife. That's something that I could get Grant in trouble if, you know, someone brought something sensitive to him and I couldn't be discreet about it. You know, if I instead was like, oh, well, I found this information out about so-and-so. That's a really tangible way to explain it. But I think the fact that it just says beautiful woman in general without discretion kind of points to we all need to be discreet. We all need to be a little more careful how we handle situations or how we handle other people. Amanda?
An excellent wife is the crown of her husband, but she who brings shame is like rottenness in his bones.
I had a teacher talk about this verse, and just the mental imagery of your bones rotting, I can't even imagine. Like, that sounds painful. It sounds gross. and to think about a woman or a wife who brings shame on her husband is as bad as that. That's hits home a little hard sometimes.
You know, bones support our body. And so the example there is she's not, you know, when she brings shame on her husband, she's not supporting
him. Mm-hmm. She's not his helper.
Framework.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, this idea of the wife being the crown of her husband is something that Grant talks about a lot. I don't know that he said it from the pulpit, but it's one of the things that, I don't know who taught it to him along the way, but he's been really good about, like, even when he's talking about other people, he's like, well, that's his wife, and she's, like, a crown, and you don't treat a crown, like, you don't throw it in the mud, you don't treat it willy-nilly, but you treat it special, and you clean it, and you take care of it, and I'm hoping that he'll do some men's stuff and talk about it, because it's one of the things that he really enjoys talking about, and I think there are a lot of men who miss that sometimes, so this is definitely one of our favorites in Fuller House. All right.
A foolish son is ruined to his father, and a wife's quarreling.
Quarreling wife. So, in the instance of suitable helper, it kind of does the opposite when we're quarrelsome or bickery, maybe. I'm trying to think of a more updated word because we don't really say quarrelsome, but someone who picks fights a lot is like a continual dripping of rain. Or if someone leaves a faucet on and you're stop dripping.
Chinese torture treatment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So, these two are more, well, I guess in a way, they're all kind of things that the Proverbs writer could have been Solomon. It could not have been. I didn't really make note of where they are. But at any rate, he was making the point that women who are lacking in discretion, women who bring shame, women who quarrel, are more of a hindrance than a help to their husbands. Or not even just their husbands, but to their sons, to their fathers, who fill in the blank. The people that they're made to be helping, they're causing more problems than helping. Would you like to go, Julie?
Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and as himself is its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands.
Something I want to point out about this verse is it's specifically saying, wives, submit to your own husbands. And this is not like man is superior to women, and therefore women are superior to you. submissive to every man. I know there are cultures, right, who take this and really run with it, and that's not what this is intended to be. Instead, as we've talked about in previous weeks, this is more a recognition of my husband is responsible for my spirituality, for how I do in this world, whether or not I make it to heaven. And so if I care about helping him get to heaven, I'm going to submit to him and let him do what he's supposed to do. And so that's something I wanted to really make note of here. This is not like, well, wives are just lesser, and so you're just supposed to listen to whatever a man tells you. This is specifically submit to your own husbands, and we might put a little parentheses because it's his responsibility to take care of you. So, anything else? Thoughts?
And it certainly doesn't apply. I remember we had a young couple in high school that thought that, like, a woman could take a position in a job where she was over men.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Said it's yours.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, and, well, people, this can get kind of misconstrued and taken in a lot of different ways, but well, suffice it to say, especially for our study, it's talking about your relationship with your husband and his responsibility and your responsibility is you're supposed to be what he needs to help him do what his job is, and his job is to be responsible for you. So... All right, let's see. I think that's Felicia, right? Yeah.
Well, older women likewise are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good and so train the young women to love their own husbands that the word of God may not be reviled.
And I think Peggy mentioned this a few weeks ago. This is one of the few things that are specifically told women. This is one of your responsibilities. And it's one of the responsibilities that we have is to teach the younger women. It's kind of interesting to me the phrasing young women, or train the young women to love their own husbands. Because we think about, like, you know, when you marry your husband, you love them, and love comes naturally, and you're supposed to feel this bubbly, you know, whatever, bubbly love, and if that's what marriage was about, we would not have to train newlyweds how to love their spouse. And I'm not saying that's not part of it, because, I mean, most of us are married, so we know that there's some of that bubbly love, but you can't train someone to love someone else that way, but you can train them to be submissive in the appropriate way. You can train them to help their husbands, to be patient with them, you know, these sorts of things.
Of course, in this time, I mean, it may have been arranged marriages, I'm assuming, in this society when this was written.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
there's
they may not have really known who they were fixing to marry very well.
Right.
I mean, maybe sometimes they knew them from a child and knew this is the person I'm going to marry, but that still wouldn't mean they loved them or had that, you know,
right,
warm, fuzzy feeling about them.
Right.
But
yeah,
that means then you can learn to love.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not all about that warm, fuzzy feeling. Because if all you have is that warm, fuzzy feeling, you know, I mean, I'm not saying that goes away, but there's this infatuation that does go away, and true love lasts.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and maybe that's part of the problem in our, you know, why we have so many divorces. Just because, you know, it's not, maybe there's not real love, and we don't wait to make sure it's love, and we don't teach this, you know, that first thing that attracted you, you know, over time things change. So, you know, you've got to, you know, there's got to be more than just that.
Mm-hmm. And some people take that to mean, well, that just means that you didn't wait long enough to get married, right? They're like, oh, well, you only dated for 5 years. That wasn't long enough, clearly, because you still fell out of love with them. And it's like, well, wait. That's not exactly what that means. What that means is you're missing a component here. If marriage was intended to last, then you're, like, there's something fundamentally wrong within the marriage, and that's why it broke down. It's not just, well, you didn't wait long enough, or you didn't know the person long enough. Sometimes that's the case. Sometimes, you know, people jump into something and they don't really know the person, and that's a different story. But especially when you talk about someone who dated like 7 years and then got married and then 4 years later they're divorced, well, it couldn't have just been they waited, they didn't wait long enough to get married. It's a little deeper than that. So other things in this verse, women are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers, slaves to much wine. I might add there, slaves to much wine doesn't only have to mean like alcohol. It could be slaves to pretty much fill in the blank. Like, I know for me something, I'm on social media a lot, and that's something that if all of my time is taken up by anything, if all of my time is taken up by my job, if all of my time is taken up by whatever it is, we've become a slave to that thing, and that thing has changed our ability to be a helper, to be supportive of what they need. Women are to, older women, to teach what is good, train young women, so that the word of God may not be reviled. So these are all good things that we are to have as helpers to the men in our lives.
Wait, we had a lady in bed's wall, who taught a loving husband's course. She's written a book. Mm-hmm. We're selling the book's worth of money. Mm-hmm. And somebody else taught it first before we ever went there. And that's how it was Patsy Logan. And that's how she got into it. And so she developed it, and she offered it probably once a year in Mexico. Community would come to it. And you had assignments, and of course, there was a lot of scripture in it. And it was really good. She and Mr. Whitty had a really beautiful relationship. And she was just, anyways, it was really interesting to take the course, you know. Mm-hmm. And she taught you to think about not just reacting, but to be on top of a situation and learning how to control instead of just reacting to whatever might come up between you and your husband, but it's, you know, look at it more maturely and deeper, and you know, there's so many good points in there. But it's a great book to get and read, and it's kind of fun too.
Mm-hmm.
The things that they did in their marriage, she shared a lot of their life and mm-hmm. the things that they did. So it's a great book to get, and mm-hmm. it's a resource too. But you can use it as a classmate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you mentioned the idea of not reacting. I think that it's really interesting. A lot of people are like, well, women are over-emotional, and women just react to everything, and that may be true, but I don't know how many, this might show my age, I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with the movie Steel Magnolias, but like, the whole movie is about the emotional strength. The whole movie is about the emotional strength of women, and it's really interesting to me that we're seen as these, like, overly emotional people, but I think more women are the stronger emotional person than men that I can think of. Not to say that men are emotionally weak or anything, but it's just interesting. And I think what happens is we learn to react rather than gauging the situation, figuring out what's going on, the best way to approach different people. And it's a learned skill for sure, like to not react. But I also think that's one of the ways that God equipped us as helpers to help them. Because a lot of times they just don't catch things the way we catch them. They don't catch, like, I don't know, body language sometimes. Sometimes it's the way something was said. And if
there is something to a woman's sexual intuition.
Yes, yes. We have that for a reason, and it's there. It just is. And if we learn to not react, that's one of the ways that we fill this role better. And it's just, you said that, and I just thought about, like, people are always like, women are so emotional, and they just fall apart at every whim. Well, that may be the case, but that doesn't mean that we have to be like that. And that's something that maybe we need to work on as an individual. Maybe I need to work on not being so responsive or whatever. And let's see. 2 Timothy 1:5. I think this is the last one. I'll read it. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. This one's a little bit different, but the mention of Timothy's grandmother and mother points to the role that women have as, especially with their children, pointing them in the right direction. Timothy's father was a Greek. He was not a Jew. Lois and Eunice were both Jews. And so the idea here is that Timothy grew up as a Jew and then he became a Christian. And I don't know specifically that his father wasn't a part of the church, but I do know that clearly his grandmother and mother had a really strong impact on his faith. And as a helper, especially to our kids, we can be that, but I think also for our husbands, we can be kind of that solid foundation maybe for them to keep building on. So, something to point out. Oh, I have one more. This one's really long. I guess I'll go ahead and read it. This is 1 Peter 3:1-6, if you can't read it and would like to flip there. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. For this is how the holy woman who women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord or Sir. And you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. So just a few things from these verses. We have the idea of women or wives. So that they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives. So we have wives being an example to their husbands. We have not adorning ourselves externally. When it says the braiding of hair and the putting on the gold jewelry or the clothing, that's most likely a cultural reference to a certain type of woman. I don't really want to get into that. But the idea is, instead of putting all of your emphasis on what you look like, on a facade, instead putting your energy into creating or strengthening the person, the character that you want on the inside, if you're good, if you're kind, if you're charitable, if you're loving, all those things. And the last thing I wanted to notice, the last verse, verse 6, says if you... That's wrong. You are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. What's interesting is several times throughout the New Testament, Christians are referred to as Abraham's children if they're faithful. That's especially in Hebrews 11 and 12. And here, the same idea of being one's child based on how you act or how you reflect the same characteristics they do, that's just kind of an interesting point. But the idea is that when you put more effort into who you are and how you respond to your husband and how you help him, or even if you're not married, how you respond to your kids or your whatever, your father, you can be considered a daughter of Sarah, which is kind of, I don't want to say a badge exactly, but it's like an honor. All right, so this week we're going to talk about women in society. This is kind of our transition. Next week we're going to talk about women in the church and in the family and some of our roles that we'll fill. in these different aspects of our lives. What do we generally know or believe about women in society in the Bible? What are some things that you guys know you've heard before about women and their place, maybe in society? Is there much that we've heard?
It's usually not too good.
Yeah.
Historically, culturally, they didn't have rights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of people point to the Bible and they say, well, the Bible depicts women as lesser, and therefore, why would we be Christians or why would we be Jews or whatever? While there are specific stories, there are things that happen in the Bible, there are a lot of things that happen in the Bible that we don't condone. Like, let's see. Well, there's Lot and his daughters, right? We don't really condone incest, but it happened. And so the thing about the Bible is that it's not just like the Bible paints all these beautiful pictures of good things and only good things. It paints real life, and we glean from it what God intends for us as people. And so there are aspects to women in the Bible that are negative, but they're not all like that. We do have examples of difficulties that women faced in society in the Bible. We'll look at a couple. So we've got Ruth and Naomi. If you're familiar with the story of Ruth and Naomi, so Naomi is Ruth's mother-in-law. Her husband dies. Then both of her sons marry women in Moab, which is not an Israelite nation. And then both of their husbands die, so Naomi is left with her two daughters-in-law. And Ruth and Naomi travel back to Jerusalem, and they're trying to find a way to support themselves while they can't have jobs. And they end up relying on a next of kin, which thankfully in their situation was a godly man, but we know that that doesn't always happen, and that didn't always happen in the Bible. Just like similar things don't always happen today. Kids sometimes go to live with family members when they've been taken from their parents or their parents die, and those situations are not always good. So those things happen, right? So that was a difficulty. Esther, just a quick thing about Esther. It's never really mentioned that Esther agreed to marry the king. She didn't necessarily agree to be in the running for queen. She didn't necessarily agree to be the queen, but she was wrapped up in all of that and became the queen. And 1 Kings 17, 8-24 is a story of Elijah, who stayed with a widow. That widow was poor. She lived with her son, and she was literally, she said to him, I have one loaf that I can make, and then I was going to make it, and me and my son were going to lay down, and we're just going to wait till we could die, because we have nothing. So clearly, there are times in the Bible where women didn't have anything. However, that is not where the story ends. We have examples of positive roles that women played in society. Women had jobs in the Bible. Women owned property in the Bible. Women were charitable in the Bible, and usually to be charitable, you have to have something to begin with. We'll get through probably women had jobs, and we'll see where we can go from there. All right, so some of the big examples that I have of women who had jobs. Deborah was a judge, and judges, I mean, they're brought cases, people plead either side, and Deborah would help them to figure out how to deal with whatever their situation is. Deborah is very highly spoken of in the Old Testament. She had a good standing in society. She was viewed as, I mean, she was a good judge. She was called the mother want to say the Mother of Nations or something. I should have looked that up, but I didn't, so I apologize. It's somewhere in Judges 4. And then Proverbs 31, 16, 18, and 24 are all from the Proverbs 31 woman, talking about buying land. She made goods. She knew the goods were good. She knew the products were good. She sold them, that sort of thing. Lydia was a maker of purple, which means she dyed clothing probably or other textiles. Textiles, that's not right. Anyway, she dyed things. And the fact that she dyed purple was a status symbol. And so she probably made pretty good money dyeing things purple. And then Priscilla is actually in the verse where she and her husband Aquila are mentioned, there it says they were tent makers, which means she was also a tent maker. So clearly women were not just, you know, at home doing nothing. They had jobs. Some of them, like the Proverbs 31 woman, sounds like she had several different things that she was good at. Women in the Bible owned property. So the story of Aksa in Judges 1, 14 through 15, it's a pretty short little thing, but basically Aksa is married off to a man who goes up to fight, I want to say it's the Midians, but I may be wrong about that, so don't mark my words there. And when they get married, she goes to her husband and says, please ask my father for this land. And her husband kind of brushes her off. And so instead, she goes straight to her dad and says, please give me this land, and he gives her the land. So she's got her land. The Proverbs 31 woman again, she goes to survey a field for herself, and the implication there is she buys the field and she uses it to do her work. And then in Luke 10:38, the house that Mary, Martha, and Lazarus welcome into is called Martha's house. Now, it may be it was her husband's house and her husband died. It's not likely that it was her father's house, because if it was, it would have gone to her brother. So it's called Martha's house. That means it's Martha's house, however she got it, but it was her house. Women were charitable. So the Proverbs 31 woman is mentioned as... I can't remember the exact words. While I'm flipping there, I'll tell you about Tabitha. Tabitha was a widow in Acts, and she had died, and Paul, I believe, it looks like a little before Paul, so maybe Peter. They find out that Tabitha had died, and all of these women from the community bring her... bring him these tunics that she had made them, and says, you know, basically, this woman was really good. She made me this clothing. And so she, from her means, gave to other people. And I want to say the phrase is that she... opens her hand, I think. Yeah. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hand to the needy, is the phrase used for the Proverbs 31 woman. And so that's just something good to note, that in order to be charitable, you have to have something. And they had something. All right. So for next week, what I want you guys to think about a little bit which of the biblical examples of a woman in society can you relate to the most, and why? You can use the examples that I provide, or if you think of something else, you can use that as well. But that's kind of something to think on this week, something to bring to class next week, or I guess 2 weeks, because I won't be here next week. So, any questions? y'all are free to look at this book before I leave, or later if you decide you'd like to. Anything else? I'm sure the bell's about to ring.
There we go.
Thank you.